How should you modify your zone two training sessions in the summer when it's hot? This is what we're gonna look at today in this video. But before I answer this question and give you a few tips on what you can do, we're gonna try and explain and understand what is happening inside the body when it's hot outside and how that is going to influence your physiology and how it's gonna influence your performance as well. So to begin with, what we have to understand is that on a normal day, when it's not summer and it's not hot, you can imagine that most of the blood circulating in your body during exercise, whether you're running or cycling or else, most of the blood is going to be used to transport oxygen to your working muscles. So maybe out of 10 units of blood, let's make it as simple as we can, 9 units are being devoted to kind of fueling your effort, right? So they're feeding the muscles, bringing oxygen, getting carbon dioxide out of it, bringing sugars, bringing fats, bringing nutrients. And that the one unit that is unaccounted for so far in my explanation is what's there to still power your brain, power your internal organs, and all the other stuff, kind of basic maintenance, right? So that one unit kind of stays dedicated to that. But now if we go into a context where it's hot outside, your body is trying to manage that internal state. It's trying to always go back to homeostasis, that metabolic or internal equilibrium. And for that, it's going to have to dissipate the heat that is being generated inside, right? Because we're actually very inefficient in the work that we do. Most of the work that we produce internally is being lost as heat. Well, lost or not, that's another debate or another video for another day. But essentially, we are going to produce heat when we exercise, and the body has to get rid of that heat in order to keep all of its numbers where they need to be in order to function. And the way the body does that when it's hot and when your body runs hotter in the summer is that it's going to redirect some of that blood towards the skin in order to radiate that heat outside of the body. So now if we take again our 10 units of blood and there's this one unit that's always dedicated to kind of basic functions, well, now instead of having 9 units that are bringing oxygen to and nutrients to your muscles, maybe you only have 6 or 7 units that can do that, and you have 2 or 3 units that are now dedicated to getting rid of that internal heat and going towards the skin, which is typically why you see heart rates going higher when it's hot, right? So in my mind, you have 2 options when that happens. The first option, if you wanna make sure that that low intensity session remains a low intensity session, remains a very low cost for your body and for your recovery and for your overall training load, the best thing to do is actually to slow down. So if we take the same case I used yesterday, somebody's on the bike and they're riding maybe a first threshold at 150 watts, second threshold at 230 watts. Well, you might do your typical zone two around 130 watts. But in case of pretty intense heat, you might want to drop that to 100 or 110 watts because that extra heat is going to add more strain on the system. But we want to maintain an easy session, so we drop the speed. Same on the run. You would just run a little bit slower if you wanted to still do a zone two session, but it was hot outside. Now, the other option that you have is actually using that heat to your advantage, because you do get benefits from training in the heat. The only thing is that you have to consider that as an extra stressor. And so now that zone two session is not easy anymore for your body, and you have to consider it as a harder session. Sure, it's not as hard as a very intense HIIT training session, for example, or a sprint interval training or anything like that, but it's still not going to be as easy as a low intensity session in a colder environment. So you can pick which aspect or which choice you make here. To give you a concrete example, right now, Claudia Gluck, the French CrossFitter, she's preparing for the CrossFit Games. Second year she qualified for the Games. The Games are at the end of July. They're in the state of New York, and it's likely going to be hot. I don't think there's going to be a lot happening outside, but we never know. And I do want her to be as comfortable as possible in the heat. So on the Saturday, she does a rowing and skiing session that is dedicated to heat adaptation. So it's a low intensity session on paper, but because she's wearing a sweatsuit, because we're targeting those adaptations, it is gonna make it harder than if she just did a zone two session on those different machines. And so we have to consider that in her training load. So we're probably gonna be closer to a 5, maybe even a 6 out of 10 in terms of RPE for that session, compared to a normal zone two session, which is typically closer to 2 or 3 out of 10. So again, you can decide how you want to approach this this change in temperature, and you can use it to your advantage. And the adaptations that you typically get from heat exposure during training are gonna be better sweat control. So you're gonna sweat more. You're gonna retain more minerals while you sweat. And that's typically why, when you're not used to sweating a lot, you see those white marks on your clothes after training. That's actually minerals that you lose during the sweating process. But as you sweat more, your body gets used to it and gets used to retaining more of those minerals while you sweat. So that's a good thing for you as well. You're also gonna be better at managing that internal heat. And in the case where you have enough exposure to that heat, it seems like you might get some increase in plasma volume. Essentially, your body just creates more blood. Why? Because it doesn't have enough to do the job, right? Remember, those 9 units go into your legs. Well, now there's only 6 or 7 units, and the other 2 or 3 are being redirected to the skin. Well, the body's like, damn, if I had more blood, it would make things easier, right? I could do more of that overall work. I could bring more oxygen to the muscles. I could keep dissipating that heat better through the skin. So, okay, let's create more blood, more plasma. But it does take a lot of exposure to that type of training. It does take time. It's even used now as a way to retain adaptations you might get through altitude training, which is really interesting. We could talk about that in another video if you'd like. Drop me a comment below. But you have to consider that. It's either going to be an easier than usual zone two session in terms of intensity, if you want it to remain that way, or it's going to be slightly harder than zone two in terms of intensity, simply because of the heat factor. But that will also help you acclimatize and accommodate to the heat. And if you're aiming to compete in hot environments, it's always a good idea to get used to it, because if you only train when it's cold in the morning and then your competition's in the afternoon in the blazing sun, it's gonna hit different and you're not gonna like it. So make sure you prepare for it. And while we're on the topic of zone two, I had a question on yesterday's video on the French channel about the relationship between the first and second threshold. So the first threshold is essentially the top of zone two in a 5-zone model. And the second threshold is gonna be kind of middle of zone four, right? Where you transition from that medium intensity, where you have kind of a systemic steady state, where you go towards the high intensity, where you lose that internal balance and you go towards high lactate values, high heart rate values, high VO2 max values, and have to slow down eventually because it's an unsustainable effort for your body. And I had a question regarding the relationship between the first threshold and critical speed in running. I have quite a bit of data on critical power on the bike. Tested hundreds of CrossFitters on the bike erg. I've tested other athletes as well, but that's kind of my main demographic. And I've seen a spread between 50 and 80%, meaning that the first threshold for the people that I've tested spans between 50% of critical power and 80% of critical power. And what influences that? Two main factors that I see are going to be your muscle topology, muscle typology. Is that the word? I'm trying to think if that's the right word in English. Correct me in the comments if I said the wrong word or if my intonation was off. It sounds off to me, but I'm not sure. Muscle typology, meaning your proportion of slow and fast switch fibers, knowing that about half of it is inherited genetically. So your type 1 to type 2 ratio, let's say, is going to be half influenced by your genetics and about half influenced by your training. So we can change those things up to a degree. And what I've seen in my estimation, or in my experience, is that people with a faster muscle typology, so they have more fast twitch, more powerful athletes, they tend to have a first threshold that is lower relative to their critical power. So they'd be maybe in the 50 to 60% range for their first threshold relative to their critical power. And on the other side of the spectrum, more endurance profiles that have more slow twitch fibers. Why? Simply because slow twitch fibers have more mitochondria, more capillaries. Essentially, they're more efficient from an energetic standpoint. They can't produce the same power as the fast twitch fibers, but they can sustain it much, much better over time. And typically with those athletes, we see a first threshold that is at a higher percentage of that critical power. And another aspect that influences that number is obviously your experience with endurance training. If you've never done endurance training, you're going to be on the lower end of the bracket. And if you have more experience, years of experience in endurance training, you're going to be on the higher end of the bracket. So that's the data that I have for critical power on the bike. And I saw, pulled up a study yesterday that was looking at the relationship between the first threshold and critical speed in running. And they did a little meta-analysis of different studies. And what they found is that on average, we'll have somewhere between 80 and 85% for that first threshold relative to critical speed. But I would hypothesize that we could see some much lower percentages for that first threshold in populations that are less trained. And so I think if I had to give it a guess, I would say somewhere between 65 and 85% would be the spread, depending on the type of athlete, like I said before, and depending on the level of running. And what they did see in this meta-analysis is that essentially people that had better conditioning in running had a first threshold that was at a higher percentage of their critical speed. I think the numbers in there were between 80 and 84%. So if you had a lower critical speed, I think it was below 12 kilometers per hour, something like that, you were somewhere between 80 and 82% on average. And for the high group that had a critical speed above 15, I think it was, or above 14, I forget, you were likely to have a first threshold somewhere between 83 and 84% of your critical speed. That study is in free access, so you can look at it yourself and make up your own mind about this. But essentially, those are the two things to consider: level of the athlete, muscle typology, and the distribution of their muscle fibers. And those things will answer most of the question when it comes to where is a first threshold relative to critical speed or critical power, whether we're talking about the run or the bike respectively. Thanks for watching this video. Drop me a comment if you have other questions. For those who want some free stuff, check out my free cardio guide, link in the description. And for coaches, physical preps that want to learn more about endurance and endurance programming, I'm going to be running my endurance mastermind in English for the first time soon. You can sign up for the pre-registration list down below as well. I'll see you there, and see you in the next video.